Hello and welcome to this conversation brought to you by Samvada. We have with us Dr. Vikram Sampath, renowned scholar, author, and a man of many interests and achievements. And today we will be discussing about Swatantravir Vinayak Damodar Savarkar, also known as Veer Savarkar. Veer Savarkar has been in the news most recently due to the Bharat Ratna issue and also partly due to the author himself because he published his most recent work, Savarkar Echoes from a Forgotten Past. So we are going to have a wonderful conversation with the author today. Welcome, Dr. Sampath.
Thank you, Dr. Raghavatham. Thank you.
So before we get started, a brief introduction about the author himself, although he needs no introduction actually. Dr. Sampath, as I said, is a man of many interests. He has a PhD in history and music from the University of Queensland. Although he started off with math and engineering from BITS Pilani, he has an MBA as well. He has authored many books, including one on the Odayars of Mysore and also on the musician from Kolkata, Gauhar John, which has been made into a movie, I believe.
Yes.
But his most recent, probably his magnum opus so far, is the work on Savarkar, and we will be discussing that in this conversation. Dr. Sampath, I'll start off with a couple of questions,
yeah,
which are sort of partly related. Mm-hmm. First of all, why Savarkar? What brought you to Savarkar? And then the second question is, it looks to me perhaps that the way Savarkar has been looked at by scholars, by intellectuals, by the media, even by the politicians, is somewhat one-dimensional and perhaps even one-sided in many ways, which looks scandalous considering the man's stature and content.
True.
So what are your thoughts on these?
Yeah. So, you know, as a student who was growing up in the central syllabus, I don't remember ever having read about Savarkar in my history textbook in school, honestly. And not only Savarkar, there was no mention even about the cellular jail or the other, you know, political prisoners who along with him underwent so much of physical torture there. So our history has been so monochromatic in the way it's presented, particularly, you know, in academics.
Yeah.
And it was much later, though I was a history buff myself,
yeah,
I knew that there was someone like this who existed, but I didn't know much details about him. And I think the way he catapulted into the national scene,
yes,
so many years after his death was in 2003 when under Mr. Vajpayee's government,
yeah,
you had his portrait coming up in the Central Hall of Parliament,
yeah,
and there was a lot of controversy. The Congress members boycotted that function. And around the same time with Mr. Ram Naik's initiative, you had the plaque, a memorial plaque of Savarkar in the Kalapani cellular jail.
Yeah.
And 1 year later, you had this very ugly episode of Manishankar Iyer having
yes,
getting that you know, dispossessed. He had lots of uncharitable things to say about him. And that was the time when I really started, you know, reading about this man,
yeah,
saying, who is this who, after so many years after his death,
yeah,
he still invokes such a lot of passion and also polarized opinion among people.
Yes.
And ever since then, and particularly, I think, more after 2014 and with the coming of the Modi government,
yeah,
almost every election rally, Savarkar's name is invoked either by his proponents or opponents.
Yes.
You have Rahul Gandhi mocking him somewhere. Then
yes,
Savarkar's grand nephew, Ranjit Savarkar, sends a defamation case against him.
Yes.
Then you have Mr. Modi going to the cellular jail, paying his obeisances to him there.
Yeah.
You have the Rajasthan government deciding whether to have Veer prefixed to his name or not in textbooks.
Yes.
Chhattisgarh chief minister saying, you know, he was the proponent of the two-nation theory. You had the NSUI activists who blackened his bust in the Delhi University. So, though he's been long gone, his
yeah,
presence in contemporary politics is so very, you know, ubiquitous.
Yeah.
And as a historian, when I look back, saying, what is it that I can read and
yeah,
find out about this man who evokes so much of emotions, positive and negative.
Yeah.
I was quite astounded, as you rightly said, there's so little written about him in recent times. The last biography, complete biography of his was by Dhananjay Keer, maybe way back in 1970s when he was still alive, Savarkar was still alive, and after that it was published. So after that, I mean, there have been so many biographies of Gandhi, Nehru, Patel, Netaji, and all of them are being rediscovered. Shyama Prasad Mukherjee is being rediscovered. But Savarkar somehow has escaped that re-evaluation, so to say. And so I felt it's almost like a historian's burden to ensure that when there are records, when there are archival material that is available, which present him in the way that he is, then it is the historian's burden to ensure that all of this is brought out for the youth of this country, for the future generations of this country. And it, I completely agree with what you said about how you know, very little has been written, accessed about him. Particularly, he wrote a lot in Marathi, and you know, that part has been almost completely not accessed or forgotten, particularly by, you know, historians outside of Maharashtra and the Marxist historians and others. So a very one-sided picture of him, either hagiography which extols him no end, is written, which is not so popular, but then the ones which are popular, the ones which demonize him completely and call him all kinds of names, all kinds of allegations. So the truth lies somewhere in the middle, as always, between these extremes of black and white, and that is exactly what I have tried to, you know, scratch that surface in my book, Savarkar Echoes from a Forgotten Past.
And I want to probe this a little further. Even conceding that from some people's point of view or certain point of view, some of Savarkar's thoughts may have been considered as controversial. For intellectuals and scholars, that should have become the substance of research, right? For example, John Kenneth Galbraith has on the record in his book, for example, Name Droppings, has clearly recorded that Nehru has told him, "I am the last Englishman ruling the country." So that should have become, for example, a very controversial statement, but I don't think many people even know about it. But in the case of Savarkar, only his most controversial thoughts have been picked up and magnified and discussed. I mean, I don't want to talk about conspiracy theories, but is there something missing here?
I think the whole idea, the fact that Savarkar was the one who propounded the Hindutva ideology in his Essentials of Hindutva in 1923 from the confines of Ratnagiri, put him in a double disadvantage. The one disadvantage is, of course, the fact that when it comes to our history, and particularly the history of our freedom struggle, we've had a very, very monochromatic linear narrative. We've always been taught, we've been indoctrinated, I think generations have been indoctrinated now, that there was just this non-violent stream which won us freedom. The jury is out as to what exactly got us our freedom. Was it the Salt March? Was it the Quit India? Was it the naval mutiny of 1946? Was it the unbroken chain of revolutionary activities that happened right from 1857 to 1946, so in which Savarkar played a very important part? So that part of you know, the alternative narrative of our freedom struggle has been completely you know, blacklisted from popular history. There are stray references to, say, Bhagat Singh or whoever else in our history textbooks, but it's not given the importance it is accorded. So on the one hand, Savarkar falls into that category of the alternative narrative, and so he's left out. The double disadvantage is also the fact that he, being a Hindutva icon and someone who propounded that theory, that makes him further, you know, a subject of neglect and derision. And probably when you see, including the Congress leaders, you have the famous quote of Indira Gandhi praising him when he died and so on. At that time, the Hindutva as a political force was probably not such a big threat to the Congress, which ruled everything from Panchayat to Parliament. Whereas particularly from the 90s, with the first NDA government under Mr. Vajpayee, and now, of course, with Mr. Modi and Amit Shah, and almost every part of India being with the BJP. So to hit on Hindutva and to hit on BJP, I think the best target, the fall guy, becomes Savarkar. And all these accusations, allegations, many of it are baseless, without much nuance or proof,
yes,
they keep getting hurled. And the Goebbels theory, right? I mean, you keep narrating one lie many, many times, then it starts assuming the truth.
Yeah.
And here, the Goebbelsian propaganda has gone on for two, three generations now.
Yes.
So people have tend to agree whatever is being told about this man. At least he had the grace to say that we have nothing against him as a man.
Yes.
You can have political differences, and I think Savarkar himself would have been very appreciative of that, because
absolutely,
he was a liberal in the true sense of the term, where he would always invite people who had views opposed to his to come and discuss in the true Indian tradition of Shastrarth, to sit and have a
absolutely
discussion
absolutely
and ensure that your
have
viewpoint
a dialogue,
have a dialogue discussion, and that's the bedrock of a good democracy, and so that's perfectly fine. But these name calling, the two based on half-baked information or untruths, I think that becomes very, very problematic, especially when we're dealing with a patriot like him who has sacrificed so much for the country, and not only him, his entire family. I think we must, those who oppose him, they must have some sense of balance and some sense of caution before making such loose allegations.
Yes. And when you studied Savarkar's involvement, the way he plunged himself into the freedom movement and how we looked at it, what are the fascinating or distinguishing aspects that you see? Because there are many shades of people who have taken part in the freedom struggle.
Right.
So it is not like one monolith.
True.
Although Indian National Congress sort of comes to the forefront, especially after 1915, probably.
Yeah.
But how do you find Savarkar's approach and involvement, and how did he respond to the colonial rule as a scholar and historian?
Right. So, I mean, when we talk of revolution and revolutionary, we usually locate it within a Marxist kind of a paradigm. Whereas in Savarkar's case, he was not influenced by Karl Marx at all, thankfully. And he drew inspiration from the Italian revolutionaries, Mazzini and Garibaldi, and all the European secret societies, which Thomas Frost also, documents in his book. And so very early in life, when he was a young man, he started India's first organized secret society called the Mitra Mela, which later became the Abhinav Bharat. And contrary to what we normally assume, that revolutionary activity was just done in spurts, some young hot-blooded men who threw bombs and killed someone and then got executed, it was not so. When I actually sifted through the material, there was a lot of organized strategy, a lot of thinking that went into it. Savarkar and his brother Ganesh Damodar, Baba Rao, actually created a vast network of revolutionaries, particularly with Bengal, Anushilan Samiti and Swadhin Bharat and others, and later Punjab. So to create, he drew inspiration from the 1857 uprising, which he called the first war of Indian independence, in which I think Mr. Amit Shah also mentioned that but for Savarkar, it would have been relegated to history because as a sepoy mutiny, as a very, undermine its importance.
Yes.
But he coined that phrase, the first war of independence, by writing that book, seminal book on it.
Yeah.
So he drew inspiration from that, and the philosophy remained the same till 1946, that the best way to get your freedom from the British was not through these petitions that the moderate faction of the Congress was doing, or go on fast and satyagrahas, but then through armed revolution, and that by infiltrating the army, because the army, the British Empire stood on the foundation of lots of Indian soldiers.
Yeah.
Now, if these Indian soldiers, their patriotic spirit was rekindled and they could be defected over to your side, then that would bring in freedom much faster.
Being a rational thinker, he's correct that he thought that way.
Yes. So then when you know the goal, how do you get there?
Yeah.
So you have to, since we were, Indians were, prevented from having arms, the Arms Act and Rowlatt Act and all that.
Yeah.
So how do you, then again drawing inspiration from Italian revolutionaries, Young Italy and so on, which Mazzini had started, how do you smuggle arms into India, pistols, bombs, bomb manuals to manufacture these bombs? Political assassination, not just for the sake of killing, but only to make a point. And he was actually against political assassination several times when some of his followers said, we'll go and blow this one up and that one up. He said, no, let's
record.
I've mentioned it in the book that we'll wait till the iron is hot. Let's not it should not be an irrational activity. It's a last resort. And the ultimate aim was to get arms, get trained in arms and fighting, and then infiltrate the army and get back to this. And that's exactly what happened with the INA as well, the Indian National Army,
yeah,
where it's on record where Rash Bihari Bose and Netaji Subhash Chandra Bose say they were inspired by Savarkar,
yeah,
and many of the young men who joined the British Indian Army, who were asked to enlist the army,
yeah,
on Savarkar's advice, have spoken that in military intelligence reports that,
yeah,
we were advised by him, and we later crossed over to the INA, and this actually gave the INA its soldiers,
yeah.
And as I said, the naval mutiny of 1946 in Bombay was perhaps what
Absolutely.
Got us our freedom, along with, of course, the tottering economy of Britain after the Second,
yeah,
World War.
Yes.
So this approach of his, you know, of him being such a firebrand revolutionary,
yeah,
and also somebody who provided such a large intellectual corpus,
yeah,
to the revolutionary movement in India,
yeah,
was a revelation for me, because I didn't know that. His book, the 1857 book, was almost a veritable Bible for
yes,
revolutionaries many decades after it was you know, published. Bhagat Singh drew inspiration from it. He got the second edition of the book published.
Yeah.
In fact, he would make that as an entry criteria for young revolutionaries to join the HSRA.
Yeah.
There's one Durga Das Khanna, who,
yeah,
later became a congressman but was a revolutionary in his younger age.
Yeah.
He says in an interview which I accessed, where Bhagat Singh and Sukhdev meet him and ask him, what are the books you read?
Yeah.
And among other things, they asked him specifically, have you read the works of Savarkar? Have you read The Life of Barrister Savarkar by Chitragupta?
Okay.
And 20 years later, you had Subhash Chandra Bose and Rash Bihari Bose getting these books translated into Japanese. Tamil versions of that were found in INA raids,
yes,
with Jayamani Subramaniam, one of the public relations officers of,
yeah,
INA.
Right.
So it just showed that, you know, he had created such a legacy for the revolutionary movement and an inspiration for revolutionaries way beyond his active revolutionary life
yes,
himself. And that to me was quite a revelation.
Yes. So he was a leader in that sense, in the true sense of
yes,
the word. He
yes,
inspired so many.
In fact, Rash Bihari Bose, in a Japanese magazine, Dai Ajiya Shugi, which he writes from Japan in 1939,
yeah,
he calls Savarkar a rising leader of New India.
Mm.
And he says, in saluting him, I am actually saluting the very symbol of sacrifice and valor and patriotism.
Oh.
So, and that is something.
It's unfortunate
that
none of this is known in the public domain or discussed.
That is true.
Yeah. And whenever we talk about Veer Savarkar, of course, we can't help talking about Kalapani.
Yes.
So what does Kalapani tell you about Savarkar, the person, the scholar and the patriot? Because it was like an epochal moment in his life, I would think.
Yeah, yeah. Now, he writes in his book, Maji Janmathep, where as they are going, you know, from Madras shores to Port Blair, sitting in squalor, sitting amidst, you know, people's excreta and all of that, terrible,
yeah,
heart-wrenching. He said, it feels like I was getting into my own funeral pyre.
Yes.
And we don't know whether we're going to get out of it, you know, alive or not.
Yeah.
Because once, it was a 50-year jail term that he was given, and he was to wear this badge,
yes,
on his neck saying, I'm going to be released in 1960.
Yeah.
The year was 1910 when he got in, and constantly being reminded, a young man who was in his 27, 28,
yeah,
and to be there for so long,
yes,
I think throughout that phase, and he's so candid in his memoirs,
yeah,
you know, including like how did he gather courage?
Yeah.
He said so many times when he's candid about that too, saying, I lost my willpower and I wanted to commit suicide.
Yeah.
Like many others in the Kalapani who committed suicide, there,
yes,
was Indu Bhushan Roy, Ulaskar Dutt, who went mad. Many people used to go, you know, lose their sanity,
yeah,
because the tortures that were meted out there were so inhuman.
Yeah.
The basic human facilities that are given to any human being of, you know, good food, toilet facility, medical facility, even these were not provided to Savarkar and all the other political prisoners. Now, even the timings of which you were to go to the restroom were fixed in the day, and the kind of food that was given was usually rotten food with the pieces of reptiles and insects in it. And so most often those who ate it would end up with diarrhea.
Yes.
And so if you had to go repeated times to the toilet, then you were not allowed. So most of the prisoners would defecate in their cells, and you had to sit in that, you know, in that squalor, you had to sit and eat and sleep, everything in that, and the hard work that was given of going around that kolhu, the oil grinding machine.
Yes. Where
typically a bullock is yoked to it. Here the freedom fighter was put to that, and full day in the blazing heat of Port Blair, you had to go round and round that kolhu extracting oil, which was measured 30 pounds of oil at the end of the day. And if you are not given that, you are lashed, you are denied dinner, which anyway nobody wanted to have that dinner. And most often even clothes were not provided. If clothes were given, it was the gunny sack, you know, clothes made of that. Yeah. And that would lead to skin rashes.
So how did he manage that actually?
Skin rashes. And so
in circumstances like this, people usually will say spiritual strength.
Yes.
But here he was as an atheist and rationalist.
He was not a, I mean, atheist. He was anti-ritual, but he was not anti-religion. So he writes in his memoirs that Patanjali's Yoga Sutras was something that he you know, read extensively then. And that's how he got equanimity of mind. He used to read the Bhagavad Gita, which again became a source of a lot of, you know, calm. He had his weak moments where he writes about it unashamed, that you know, so many times, some three, four times he did consider ending his life, because he was also put in solitary confinement for several, for almost 6 months.
Yeah.
And you know, months on end, it was standing handcuffs, where you have to stand in a one position with handcuffs to your hands and legs, you know, and urinate and defecate as you stand. It's not a, it, I mean, it's easy for us to make all these crazy allegations, but just one day if somebody, you know, faces this kind of a situation, you'll get to know what, you know, the truth of life is.
Yes.
And the only human contact that he had, because they were, the British considered him as a D category or a dangerous criminal. So the only human contact that he had was just his cell faced the gallows. So every day you were seeing people being dragged there, being hanged, screaming, shouting, you know, for six months, that's all that you're seeing. So how will anybody's mental strength remain what it is? But despite that, not only did he conserve his own energy, but he also was like a leader for the rest of the group, where, you know, they all looked up to him. They called him Bada Babu. He was like their leader. And he, interestingly, from all this kind of terrible, you know, situation, he transforms the situation in cellular jail to almost a model prison, where education reforms are brought in, where people are allowed to, a library is created. He starts taking classes for other people, and to promote national integration, he says, let's learn each other's languages. I'll teach you Gujarati, Marathi, someone else teaches me some other language. So that's sort of a completely different situation from the situation where they were denied even pen and paper to write, and he used to actually use his nails and, you know, carve.
We have read about
the poems, and he was a great poet, and a lot of along with spirituality, I think one catharsis for him was also his poetry. So 6,000 verses, lines of his poetry, Kamala, Saptarshi, all of this, he
monumental
inscribed on the walls. And to spite him, the very inhuman jailer Barry would come and whitewash the walls right in front of him. But little did he know that this man had such an elephantine memory, that he would you know, commit all of that to memory, and these would then get published after he got released from jail, and they have become monumental, you know, milestones in Marathi literature. So other than Savarkar the revolutionary, Savarkar the politician and all that, but also Savarkar as a literateur, someone who contributed so much to Marathi literature, to the Bhasha Shuddhi of literature, you know, how Marathi language itself was cleansed, new words were created, as a playwright, as a poet, as an orator, as a speaker. So there's so many multiple facets of this man, which I think a lot of it also emerged during Kalapani, because along with, of course, the Hindutva, the seeds of Hindutva being sown in his mind there, but also his maturity as an individual, as an as a consummate and sensitive poet and writer and artist, I think all of that also happened there. So it was a wonderful way of how he converted the pain and the suffering that one faced there. Instead of losing your life, he diverted it into something so different, and also became an inspiration for the other prisoners.
Yes. And once he came out of jail, one of his seminal work, I would say, is on the issue of samarasya or social equality. Where I think he said and did many things which are not even looked at in the public domain, I think. I mean, of course, Dr. Ambedkar has talked about, correctly so,
Yeah.
But Veer Savarkar also did many things in the same domain.
True.
And with equal sincerity and intensity.
True.
And that is not discussed much, I think.
Yeah, yeah.
So what are your thoughts on
that? Yeah, I'm so shocked when I hear allegation that he was a Brahminical, Manusmriti, yes, loving person, and that's so far away from the truth, because all his works that he wrote, for the Shraddhanand, for other papers, was always about dismantling of the caste system, because he realized in the jail that and that was something that he realized right from his childhood, the lack of unity of the Hindu society, and how a unification of the society was very much needed. So one of the first things that he did after coming out of jail and being in Ratnagiri, because he was given a conditional release that you could not participate in politics and you were confined only to the district of Ratnagiri. So the social reforms that he embarked upon there are phenomenal, and in fact Dr. Ambedkar himself writes so many eulogizing letters to him, and the views of Savarkar and Ambedkar on caste, if one reads it dispassionately, are so similar to each other.
Yes.
And Gandhi actually is on a complete tangent.
Yes.
Because Gandhi says, I don't consider the caste system as being odious. I believe in the Varnashram system.
Yeah.
I believe in hereditary professions.
Yeah.
Everybody cannot become a prime minister, a viceroy, and a prime minister. Only people who are born in certain things.
Gandhi described himself as a Sanatani.
Yes. And today, I mean, that goes against the tenets of democracy. I think a chaiwala can become a prime minister, and it's not a preserve of one particular family.
Yes.
So that is something that both Savarkar and Ambedkar, spoke about all the time, that they were nihilists, I would say, whereas Gandhi was a reformer. He was trying to make reforms within the system, whereas these people wanted to break the system completely. It's more creditable here, considering, Savarkar was a Chitpavan Brahmin himself, whereas Ambedkar, it came a lot from his personal experience of inhuman torture that he faced as a discrimination and all that as a member of the so-called lower caste. His writings, he talks about the seven shackles that bind Hindu society: Roti Bandi, Beti Bandi, Samudra Bandi, Vyavasaya Bandi, Vedokta Bandi. So inter-caste dining.
Yeah.
He says, how can someone lose one's caste or religion just by eating with someone?
Yes.
Which was what was happening in the cellular jail. They could convert someone to Islam just by feeding them some beef, and just to get rid of the whole torture, people would easily cross over.
Absolutely.
And go, and not by any conviction. They didn't even know how to read their namaz.
Yeah.
So he said, I'm opposed to that.
Yeah.
So, but then if you had to get them back into the Hindu fold, there was so much opposition from Orthodox Hindus.
That's right.
So Shuddhi Bandi, so let's break that.
Yeah.
Just as they can convert us and take us away into another, why can't we bring them back?
Yes.
The bringing back should also be as easy. So the Shuddhi practices that he started.
Yes. His advocacy. Did the two of them meet, or often Ambedkar and
couple of times they did meet.
Times.
Yeah,
okay.
And his letters are there where he lauds the efforts that Savarkar did. So intercaste dining, so he had this cafe in Ratnagiri where people of all castes could sit and eat. The Patit Pavan Mandir that he started there, where it was open to people of all castes and communities. Intercaste marriage, all of this, which actually alarmed the upper caste Hindus of Ratnagiri, saying one of us, the Chitpavan Brahmin, is doing such unthinkable, things. So he was not very popular even among the Hindus of the time, because his views were so far ahead of its times.
Yes.
And as I said, he said there's nothing Sanatan about the caste system, because if in the Bhagavad Gita, Krishna has said, I have created the four Varanas, then where from has the fifth Varana of untouchability come?
Exactly.
The very fact that it has mutated and a new Varana has come up, and also among the Brahmins there are so many subcastes, among Kshatriyas there are so many subcastes, they don't talk to each other, they don't marry each other, they don't eat with each other, that shows that this is not Sanatan. Anything that is Sanatan is eternal, it is
timeless,
immutable and timeless. So considering that, we must get rid of this, because this becomes a very easy tool for the opponent
For
to create more disunity in our community. And so that was his larger vision on the caste.
Absolutely. And I want to ask you about Gandhi's assassination and how Savarkar got embroiled in that. And you yourself mentioned that he was opposed to political assassinations.
Yeah.
And being a rationalist, and the way he went about his business, connecting him with an assassination of someone like Gandhi is illogical, actually. But he did get involved. And I would say that that probably became the biggest stick to beat him with, because someone of his stature should have been involved even in drafting of the constitution,
yeah.
right?
Yeah.
But he was never given a place in the table anywhere,
true.
Probably because of the association with Gandhi's assassination. So what are your thoughts on that? So,
I mean, Gandhi and Savarkar, I usually call them as the two irreconcilable poles of Indian history, because
yes.
they were ideologically opposed to each other all through their lives, and
yeah.
right from the time they met first in 1906
yeah.
till, you know, the very end, they had viewpoints completely different. And Savarkar was intellectually opposed to Gandhi. I
yeah.
think he kept a close watch on everything that Gandhi said and did, and he used to give his counters
yeah.
In his Shraddhanand, point by point rebuttal to what Gandhi
yeah.
Said. Now, if you actually look at the dying declaration of Nathuram Godse himself, which
yeah.
Signed affidavit which he filed in court,
yeah.
Which the Congress government suppressed for several years,
okay.
and it came out only in the late 70s,
yes.
early 80s, why I assassinated Gandhi,
yeah.
where he lists all the details as to what were
yes.
his grouses, and he says it was nothing personal against him, but he was being, he was, in his view, he was harmful for the nation at that time, and
yeah.
so on. In that, he mentions that I was a very, Godse mentions that he was a very ardent follower of Savarkar
yeah.
in the early times, and he used to keep going to the Hindu Mahasabha speeches, to
yeah.
Savarkar Sadan in Dadar in Bombay, and never got to meet him because the office was on the ground floor and he lived on the first floor. But he said somewhere down the line, I started seeing Savarkar was becoming a very pacifist person.
Yeah.
He was becoming conciliatory as especially freedom started, the specter of freedom was nearing.
Yeah.
He said, there's no point fighting with the Congress now. Let's all join hands and form this national government, which
yeah.
is our government, our Indian, free Indian
yes.
government. So that disillusioned Nathuram a lot. And he
yeah.
says that in as many words in his testimony,
okay.
saying, we slowly, with every passing day, our faith in Savarkar was getting away. He and all the other old members, Munje and others of the Hindu Mahasabha, they no longer inspired us. So we decided to break away from them and form our own militant Hindu faction.
Yes.
And he, in the last paragraph, he states clearly that all these insinuations that are made, that it was on Veer Savarkar's advice or on even he had knowledge that I'm going to fire at Gandhi, are false.
Yeah.
And the whole fact that it was such a flimsy thing that these two people went, and Apte and Godse went and met
yes.
him, and he gave a gun and said, Yashasvi hoon ya, or be successful and come. No, someone like Savarkar, even if he had to do this,
yeah.
you know, he was a strategist.
Yeah.
He would not have done this in such
Absolutely.
Open and in such, it would have been done in, you know, this was too dramatic for even Savarkar's comfort. So the very fact that this was so circumstantially weak, the
yeah.
evidence. Godse also mentions none of this has happened. This Yashasvi Hoon Ya business is also false. It's a dying man's declaration which has some sanctity and must be taken
yes.
for what it is.
Yes.
And he says this really, and the fact that Savarkar said Gandhi will not live another 100 years or some such thing that is said. He said these are all superstitions. Neither he nor I believe in such superstitions. So all this evidence was put in front of the court.
Yeah.
Now the court perused that and they found that there was nothing in it.
Yes.
And Savarkar was honorably exonerated
yes.
From the allegation of the assassination.
Yes.
But still, you
yeah.
know, the long shadow continues. I
yes.
mean, at some point, I keep saying,
today they are connecting
yes.
him. Yeah.
No, I keep saying, at some point, we have to start learning to, respect the courts and their verdict.
Absolutely.
If the court, in its supreme wisdom, has perused the
evidence
and has given the clean chit to somebody, you can't still keep accusing that person.
Yeah.
They, of course, keep bringing up the Kapoor Commission report, which was set up much later. It was a
yeah.
more politically motivated
yes.
commission.
Yeah.
And there have been so many people, legal luminaries and others, who have found fault, where very eminent witnesses, including Savarkar's secretary Gajanan Damle or
yeah.
his bodyguard Appa Kasar, they were not even called in as witnesses. There were 101 witnesses in the Kapoor Commission. These people who were supposedly the ones who said all this, Yashasvi Hoon Ya and others, they were not even brought there and
yes.
spoken to. And the terms of reference of the Kapoor Commission was not to fix blame on anybody. It was something else, and it exceeded its brief, and
yeah.
without any evidence or background, it just unilaterally says it's beyond doubt that Savarkar and his associates were involved in this murder. And Savarkarites, now that's a very broad term. There are so many Savarkarites even today who very strongly believe in his philosophy and who consider him as their hero. So does the Kapoor Commission then say everybody who's a Savarkarite is
self-acclaimed?
Is complicit in Gandhi's murder. So I think that
that sense, it's actually a character assassination of Savarkar.
Which is very true, and it unfortunately that shadow falls on him even to this day. And that's the same stick you keep beating him up with all the time.
And the remarkable nature of the man was shown even in the way he chose to die, right? How much he believed in those traditions. He was sort of ready to walk the talk in that
sense. Refused food, water, medicine, and atmahuti that he took, and also made it clear that I'm anti-ritual, so don't do all these shraddha ceremonies for me. Or even when his wife died, he refused all these things for her because he said, I don't believe in these things. So
And my last couple of questions will be, how should history, now that we know many more things today and we are discussing them openly, how should history and our current and future generations remember Savarkar? And what do you think is his legacy that we should build upon, rather than just look him up as an icon and just leave it there? And the second question would be, what are your thoughts on this Bharat Ratna controversy?
How to remember Savarkar? I think his own words, I mean, he starts his memoirs saying, when you're writing about me, think of how you would describe a rose. You know, a rose is beautiful, but then also the stem, you have to describe everything from the stem to the beautiful petals to the fragrance, but also the thorns. He says the biography should be mentioned as is and not as should be. These are his own words as to how someone needs to remember him.
Brutally honest,
candid, unashamed, unabashed about anything. So I think, and as I said, in his life he always encouraged dissent, discussion, debate. So let more people debate about it. I mean, let, if there are counter viewpoints about whatever people have to say about his so-called petitions and mercy petitions, he was a collaborator of the British, a stooge, all kinds of things that are said, as complicit in the Gandhi murder, all these things, there can be two viewpoints. So come up with facts, come up with evidence, there could be a discussion. But I think the legacy that he would leave behind is one of a pragmatist, somebody who was very practical, a very utilitarian. He believed in Spencer's utilitarian theory, where sarvajana hitaya, sarvajana sukhaya, maximum benefit to the maximum number of people. So including on thorny issues like cow worship and all that, where he says treat the cow as a utilitarian animal. It's great utility, so let us leave it there. If you really want to worship it, you do, go ahead, but I don't believe in it. I would rather protect it rather than worship it. So someone who was rational, someone who was a progressive thinker, much ahead of his times, and he said that several times in his memoirs, that while I'm alive, people will scoff at me, people will not understand what I say, but much after I'm gone is when people will understand the import of, so many of his predictions that he did in 1928-29, he writes that there is going to be a second world war, there's going to be a major calamity in the world, and this, in the first world war, we did not take advantage of it.
He's a reader of history.
First world war, we did not take advantage. So at least now let's take advantage and ensure that India becomes free, with that. He had predicted that, you should not get too cozy with China even after freedom. And you saw what happened to the Hindi-Chini bhai-bhai ending with the 62 war. So, and on Pakistan, on several of the things. And I keep saying somewhere that it's Savarkar's vision of India that has fructified today. And not Gandhi's vision, so to say. That's because, we are a militarized country, we are a strong military, which was what Savarkar stood for. A strong, self-sufficient, militarized nation, which looks at its own security. Correct. Now, every time a Balakot happens, where you enter the enemy's camp and, you know, attack.
Yes.
His book was also called Shatruncha Shibirat,
yeah.
Inside the enemy camp. So get into the enemy camp and, you know, give them,
yes,
to not, if someone slaps you, show the other cheek. That, yeah, philosophy is not something he believed in.
So in that sense, Savarkar understood the human psyche and the human society,
yes,
much better.
Yes, yes. And he stood for an industrialized nation, a capitalist economy, something that, and today we have, especially post-liberalization, the kind of you know, rapid urbanization that we have, the free market economy that we have, that's again, I think, Savarkar's vision of India that's fructifying. And his you know, idea even of the minorities, which again becomes a big issue to beat him with,
yeah,
you know, in his manifesto that he talks about, a constitution of free India, how should that be?
Yes.
He conceives where nobody should be discriminated on the basis of caste, religion, sect or gender or anything.
Mm.
A majority will not get special privileges only because one is a majority. Likewise, a minority will not,
yes,
get any. Everybody is equal in the eyes of the law. And
yes,
he specifically says, I would like to, you know, remove any ghost of suspicion from the minds of our non-Hindu brethren that any attempt, there will be no attempts to encroach upon your religious freedom or your culture, language or anything. Similarly, you should not do anything to abrogate the rights of the majority community,
yes,
say state control of temples or whatever is being done today.
Yes.
So equality for everybody, justice to all, appeasement to none, kind of a thing. A very, very just policy,
yes,
where everybody is allowed to live, but the fundamental thing is allegiance to this country,
yeah,
and your loyalty should be to this country, which is what was his Punya Bhu and Pitru Bhu,
yes,
when he defined who is a Hindu.
Yes.
That was not by religious terms, but by the fact that someone whose ancestors were born in this land and someone who reveres this land,
yes,
not holy land, not in terms of religion,
yes,
but something that you really,
deeper,
you
connections,
know, yeah, deeper, yeah, connection, and you have that loyalty and,
yeah,
sense of reverence for.
Yes.
So I think a lot of what he spoke and stood for is very, very pertinent and germane today in the geopolitical context, in the kind of thing. A simple example would be also foreign policy.
Yeah.
All through he had said he was in support of the creation of a Jewish state of Israel.
Mm.
And you see, it took a Narendra Modi to come and actually build ties with Israel, where,
yes,
we, for our vote bank politics for so many, you know,
yes,
decades,
like
a friendly nation like,
yeah,
Israel, we had,
yeah,
kept them at bay.
Yeah.
And no big achievement came out of it. So that pragmatism, what is utilitarian to you, to your country, to your community,
very clear thinker,
clear thinker,
yeah,
rational,
yeah.
I think that is his legacy, which I think young people should remember. And read him, read his works, read,
yeah,
works on him, by him, everything,
yes,
and make your mind. I mean, he was constantly against idol worship of the sense,
yes,
that don't make me into an idol.
Yes.
Now, Gandhi has become such an idol that anybody who goes against or says something, it's like, you know, blasphemy.
Yes.
So whereas he's not an idol in that sense,
yeah,
so criticize him, you know, appreciate him, but do that after reading about him or reading his works, and then based on facts you can have whatever opinion you want. And I,
yes,
think that would, what would make him more happy, rather than blind worship or even blind kind of demonization.
Yes.
His logical thinking would insist that we should understand him and then either praise,
yeah,
him or
examine,
criticize
him. Understand,
yeah,
and then form an opinion.
Yeah. And the Bharat Ratna, yeah, of course, this has been a demand, I think, from the Shiv Sena for a very,
yes,
long time, and now the,
yeah,
BJP has also jumped.
Yeah. And the question, does he deserve Bharat Ratna, seems really funny to me.
I mean who's setting the criteria? Who will
yes,
justify whether Rajiv Gandhi deserved a Bharat Ratna or somebody,
yeah,
else? So
the MGR got it.
Yes, everybody,
yes,
who gets it.
Yeah.
So, I mean, that's a part. I mean, it's symbolic. It's, and
yes,
I'm nobody to say he should or shouldn't or whatever, because it is ultimately the government's,
yeah,
decision, and it's political and so many things that come into it. But I think it's the symbolism of it would is what is more important, where for the longest time,
yes,
you know, civilian awards of this nature have been the preserve of just one family or one ideology and one group of people. So finally, by giving Savarkar a Bharat Ratna, it would be an acknowledgement of the fact that there is a parallel narrative to our,
yes,
history, to our freedom struggle,
yes,
and much, much overdue, that narrative is being recognized,
yeah,
and his contributions are being recognized.
Yeah.
It would make no impact to him or his family, who has suffered so much,
gone through so much sacrifice. But I think it's a nation's, sense of gratitude for somebody who has done so much for us. To that extent, I think it would make a very symbolic gesture to award someone like him the Bharat Ratna.
Symbolic but fitting.
Fitting, gesture. Yeah. Yes. And we've seen that even Sardar Patel and Ambedkar and others were given the Bharat Ratna so many years after their passing away. Yes. And before that, you had Indira Gandhi awarding it to herself, and then you had Rajiv Gandhi being given the award. So when all such people have been given, I think these were true heroes, true patriots of this country. They should all be also I think feted and recognized.
And I just want to close out with one question which I wanted to cover. Savarkar versus Nehru. Did they cross words, and how do you see 40-50 years later? If you just juxtapose Savarkar and Nehru, how do you see it?
I would evaluate Nehru as being much junior to Savarkar. So he, and by the time Nehru became the Prime Minister, Savarkar was way out of the political scene, and they never really got too much of time together against each other. I think the main fight was with Gandhi, and right from when they met in London in 1906, with that famous episode where Savarkar is cooking prawns, and Gandhi, being a vegetarian, is so shocked, and how is a Brahmin sitting and cooking prawns, and he asks him to eat, and Gandhi says no, and Savarkar says, this is just boiled fish. If you cannot eat with us, how will you fight with us? And we want young men who will bite the British alive. You can't even eat fish. So it was certainly not the best of first meetings. And so all through life, they had this running war, feud between each other. So Nehru, I think, had other differences, maybe with Savarkar's protege, Shama Prasad Mukherjee and others. But Savarkar by then was, I think, way too senior to cross words with Nehru.
It was a fascinating conversation, Dr.
Thank you, Dr. Agarwal.
So, thanks for your time.
Thank you.
And you are also coming up with a sequel to your book, right?
Yes.
On Savarkar.
Yeah. So, this is the first volume of the book, which covers his life from his birth in Bhagur in Nashik district in 1883, the early years of the Mitra Mela, Abhinav Bharat in Nashik, and then Pune, where he was a student in the Ferguson College, then his revolutionary years in London, along with so many other wonderful revolutionary figures of the time, Shamji Krishna Verma, Bhikaji Kama, Virendranath Chattopadhyay, and Lala Hardayal and others. Then his arrest, his time in Kalapani, the incarceration, the writing of Hindutva, and his release, conditional release to Ratnagiri in 1924. That's where volume 1 ends. Volume 2 would take the story from 1924, talk about his social reforms in Ratnagiri, and then his active political life as the president of the Hindu Mahasabha from 1937. Then of course the Gandhi murder, its various ramifications, and his death in 1966. So that book, hopefully, if I keep up my tenacity of research and writing, it should come out in another year or so.
Wonderful. The second we look volume. Forward to that.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thanks for your time.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. That's it for us. Thank you.